I would say probably what I have learned is build the team around you. If you try to do it yourself, you will fail. So build your team in accounting, build your team over in here and all that. Kind of, that's what I have learned at the beginning part of it. You try to do a lot. And I was like, no, I can't do that. Right. So I always have to consistently keep my head in the clouds. That's where I want to be. That's actually a really exciting place. So I kind of get a buzz right about now because I'm planning for next and I get myself excited and I can bring that to the team. But I can't do that without other people. I can't do that without the certain people. And one part of my team leaves, like a CFO or whatever, you feel it. And that's what I want because that means I've done the right thing as far as building the team. Yeah. So when they leave, like, you can feel it.
And I am here with Tyler Campbell. He is the founder and CEO of Tytanium Ideas. How you doing, Tyler?
I'm doing fantastic. How are you?
Thank you for joining us on this Veterans Day weekend. You are a veteran, and you're also an entrepreneur. We love both of those on this show.
So I'm like the perfect guest, right?
You are,
yes. Just fill both of them.
Well, let's see how you do here. I think you're the perfect guest, but let's hear your story first. No, seriously, though, give us an overview of Tytanium. How did it start?
Yeah.
What do you guys do?
Yeah, so digital marketing company. Actually, we did not start out that way. So here's an entrepreneurial story for you. So I was actually out with some buddies, actually two families together, and we were out at Bullard's Bar, drinking beers, down by the bonfire, forgot a bunch of stuff. I said, hey, you know, there's got to be an app for the ability to find local things that is crowdsourced before it was even really a thing. So I come back, pull out a bunch of money. I remember my wife, if she was on here, she's like, yeah, I remember when you came out of the office, was like, I got an idea. I pulled it out, made this app, got it up on iTunes, and I needed to create a company because that's how you get it on there.
Okay.
Attorney goes, what do you want to call yourself? Tytanium with a T-Y.
You made the decision in the attorney's office,
totally.
The name of the company.
And he's like, why is that? And I was like, well, in the military, I always partied harder than everybody else. I'm not proud of it now, but they could never be broken. I stayed up the longest, right? So it was Tytanium Tyler. So Tytanium Ideas was born, but it wasn't in necessarily for
Tytanium
the marketing part.
Tytanium with a T-Y.
T-Y. See what we did there?
Tyler.
So fast, so quick. Almost dumb.
How did you get your nickname, Tytanium Tyler? Okay, that sounds interesting. All right, so I hear how you named the company, business.
Yeah.
How did you get the name Tytanium?
Stayed up and hung out with everybody longer than everybody else. And so kind of like it's a strong metal, so you couldn't actually be broken. So I was always the one hanging out late at night with my military buddies.
Yes.
So that's where that
came
from.
And the partying continues at Bullard's Bar. I want to dive back. We'll dive into that.
Yeah, yeah.
I'll retrace those steps. But let's talk a little bit more about Tytanium.
Mm-hmm.
What do you guys, you're a digital marketing agency. What do you do? What's different about you guys?
Yeah, so we when we first started out, it was just social media. But that is now a spoke on the wheel, as you know. So it actually encompasses everything from design development of websites and then the content creation of how are you going to go find the our customer's perfect customer and drive them back. Right. So that is what we do. So we've got 13, soon to be 15 people.
Wow.
Busting at the seams, having an amazing time. It's such a fast moving industry.
Mm-hmm.
Space. I mean,
it's a growth industry,
right? It's so ridiculous. You know, it grows so fast. The strategy you had 6 months ago doesn't work anymore, and it's going to change in 6 months. So it's just exciting.
Marketing companies don't really look the same as they used to.
We're not the same when we were 3 years ago, 4 years ago.
Yeah. It's amazing. Okay, so let's talk about that. You know, we've been talking about getting known. You've obviously grown like crazy. You're in a good space, but I mean, how do you guys get yourself known, and how would you describe the image of your organization?
Yeah, well, it's interesting because I am always getting my head down, right, as the leader of the organization. We want to go and have the best customer experience. Sometimes we get it, sometimes we don't, but really what I would say what we're known for is how we treat our customers, but then also our culture of our organization. We get applicants weekly, all the time. And we've got clients that
we work
with. You're
talking about like job applicants?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And so I always ask, because I'm always curious too. Sometimes I don't put my head up and look to see what's out there. I go, why here? They go, because we love what you stand for and what you're about.
Interesting.
And so I spend a lot of time creating that because I want to go to work every day and enjoy it. And I want everybody else to. You know, sometimes you have your good days, your bad days, but how we press through those adversities, and I bring in a lot of the military. So I always say, to kind of tie it back to the veterans part, but we run the organization like a football team in the military. So we've got play calls, we've got nomenclatures, we've got code words, we've got a bunch of stuff so we can communicate fast and efficiently.
Almost like a no-huddle offense.
Pretty much.
I love it. So thinking about the culture, okay, so obviously your communication is great if you guys are, you know, practically hand-signaling to one each other.
Exactly.
What do you envision for the growth of the organization? Is it going to continue to grow? I mean, what do you feel like is going
to
happen?
Yeah, we are. I think that, you know, when it comes to like a football team, right, you have skill positions. Well, as the space of digital marketing grows, you're going to need to have skill positions. And so, you know, one of our culture codes is market mastery. So we really want to have people that are neurosurgeons, that are the LeBrons of their specific thing, right? Do you do digital ads as far as Google AdWords? Then you're going to be the expert at that, right? And people want to do that. They want to have that that intense individual knowledge. And so I think that there's going to be a massive amount of growth there because there's so much changing. There's bots and AI and VR and all these other acronyms that sometimes I have a hard time keeping up with. But I know my job really as the leader of that organization is to find the best people and give them everything they need to win.
Are you, so you would be more of a head coach than a quarterback?
Yeah.
So you're
evolving right now. Okay. And so I, to be honest, I'm in a weird space. It's like I was the quarterback and doing it all, and now, but now it's like, no, it's surpassing, which is exciting and terrifying at the same time, of actually having that coach mentality of going, hey, now I need to develop leaders because you have to do, I can't do it all.
Yeah, it's so much different. Well, let's relate that back to your military experience. Talk to us about your job in the military. Were there things that you gathered and gained from the military that are able to help you in terms of growing this team?
Yep, 100%. So I came into the Air Force, Airman Basic, and then was in for about 4.5 years. I was Security Forces because I didn't know any better. So I was a cop, right? So they're like, hey, see that bunch of concrete? Stare at that line for 12, maybe 14 hours. And if anybody crosses it, yell at them. That was it. So, and then I got out, inactive ready reserve. I was actually reactivated 4 days after 9/11.
Oh, goodness.
So I'm driving to work. I get a phone call 4 days later from, you know, they found me through the reserves down there at Travis. They're said, hey, pack your bags. So hang up. Go talk to my boss at the time. I just got a call, and I got to go back to Travis. So I was in for another 2 years. So from there, still in Security Forces, but I volunteered to be what's called the Phoenix Raven. And so what that is it's kind of like the equivalent to the Air Marshal, right? So at that time, everything's hot and heavy. So any Air Force asset that flew anywhere, asset being like a plane or a person or whatever, we would then go provide security for that specific thing.
Where did you do that out of? Was that out of Travis?
Out of Travis.
Okay, so you did most of it out of Travis. So you get out after 2 years with this experience in as a cop. But you're not a cop personality.
No.
You're the guy out drinking beer, having a beer at Bullard's Bar. You sound like more like me.
Totally.
I'm like that.
I'm like
used to being on that side. Right. I'm used to being on the other side of the law, but here I am growing up now. But seriously though, transferring that, you've got this creative side to you that really probably wasn't tapped into in the,
No, not at all. I didn't even know, to be quite honest. And it's funny, my LinkedIn bio, it's like, I didn't even know that entrepreneurship or an entrepreneur, what it was until I actually read it. And then I had failed so many times at so many ideas that I went, oh, that's what I have.
And interesting.
It's
like a disease.
That's exactly what I said. I said, I have a disease, but I was able to name it. And so I actually enjoy that. But through the Air Force, I mean, it just taught accountability and teamwork and leadership and so many things. And, you know, a lot of times in our world, and this is one of our core values, is finish strong. So sometimes it's a rough start or it goes this way, and that it's all how you finish.
Yeah.
You know, so I've brought that into the organization. And so, so from there, as being a Raven, we just flew around all over the world just did fun stuff and protected lots of things and lived off of couches and out of suitcase for 2 years.
Well, you know, it's Veterans Day weekend. I mean, you have people that I know that you know and respect from your time in the service. I mean, what do you think about on Veterans Day? I mean, as we all tip our caps to guys like you, I mean, what goes through your mind in those kind of, on these kind of days?
Well, I stop. There's two things that I do. I stop and I reflect, and then I also go and watch Saving Private Ryan. For some reason, when I saw that movie, I just have to watch it every Veterans Day because I go, oh, that's what I tried to carry on. And then I just say thank you to everybody who's going to be past me. So I do, it's a weird thing. I don't know why. It's just kind of like a little thing that I do because at the time it was the most real, you know. So, and being overseas in Germany, I visited a lot of those places. So that's a big thing for me is I'll take it off and just go and say that was a fun time. I'm blessed for what I learned and the experiences that I had. And then just usually send, you know, chats or texts to my buddies that were in there and go, yeah, keep going.
Yeah,
it's funny to think, you know, the colonel who was just on, I was like, man, I think we're about the same age. If I would have stayed in, what would retirement look like? I don't know.
Yeah. Well, he's got little kids like you do. Yeah. You have the little kids. Yep. I mean, when you were in, was that, what was, you had your family, did you have family support?
Oh, heck no. Are you kidding me? 19, 20, 21, flying around the world? No. Family was not even
no
in the...
No family support?
Not even in the...
What about mom and dad? Did
oh,
you
yeah,
have
yeah,
anything
mom and dad,
like that?
Totally. Yeah, no, they were involved. Yeah, that mom, she hated when I tell stories. Like, guess where I'm at today? And it's funny because I actually first listened to your show and I was driving to a client appointment, driving down to Modesto, and I think you were talking about your son, and I think something happened and something hit a can of Copenhagen.
Yes.
Yeah, I know. And I was like... Oh, I remember when I had Copenhagen. Uh-huh. And so I just in my head started going back and forth going, yeah, I got really sick.
I'll share that story really quickly here. Yeah, my son in June of 2012 was shot in the leg in Afghanistan. And the ironic thing is we could joke about it now. I mean, we were totally against him chewing tobacco, right? Yeah. Like, oh, heck no, we're not into tobacco.
What parent isn't?
And I bought him this, apparently he's in Afghanistan, and he wants some tobacco.
That's what you do.
Yes, and okay, do we do this? You know, I'm providing tobacco to my kid. Send it to him. He's on his last can of chew, and he goes out on one of his missions, and he gets shot. And it hits the can of Copenhagen, wintergreen, and we believe that it ricocheted off of the Copenhagen and probably saved his leg because he's now okay. I mean, he walks with virtually no limp, and it's like, you know what? Maybe the can of Copenhagen saved his life.
Plug for them.
Yeah.
They
I
need
mean,
to be an
awkward
be a,
commercial for tobacco,
totally,
don't you? It's bad stuff most of the time. So just amazing. So, okay, thinking about relating this back to entrepreneurship, right? Mm-hmm. I'm the... I call myself the entrepreneur next door. I am the president of the EO. You have friends that are in the entrepreneurs organization. What about the entrepreneurial community? Are you into anything in the entrepreneurial community?
Yeah, through here and there, through different organizations. But you know, that's one of the things that I think this coming year. And it's funny right now. You know, November, December. I'm doing a lot of planning for the upcoming year. I've been so heads down, eyes focused on what I'm trying to build that I don't really come up for air sometimes. And while that's good because we actually have such a good thing going, it's bad because I want to go and learn. You know, so I'm really, really hungry for that. So, and that's just the evolution of a leader and a business owner to go and say, wow, let's look around. You know, I got to look and say, hey, I got 4 hours in the day. Do I go over here? Do I go over here or this place? You know, so for my job is to invest in people and grow them. I got to be there. But now this team is like going and surpassing me. So I'm kind of like, you know, the awkward dad with the empty nest.
Well,
like,
mean,
what
I
do
think,
I do now?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I think
I'm
going
to go involved in an organization.
It's the biggest decision we as business owners need to make is how to allocate resources, starting with you, right? You are, as the player coach, if you will, quarterback slash coach. I mean, how you spend your time is most critical. I mean, how does a guy like you at this stage of the game, how do you spend your time? I mean, you're not coming up for air. Obviously, you've got a family. I wonder how you allocate your time.
Well, right now, I will, you know, plug for my team, but they are amazing in the sense of, and I could go back to the message right now, they're like, please trust us, just leave, just get out of here. And I go, okay, great. Okay, it's just like letting go. So that is a big thing that is freeing up time. But, you know, I've been really, really hungry for knowledge and reading a lot this past year and came across, I think it was Warren Buffett, Bill Gates, but they said, you know, thinking is a lost art. And so they made mention as far as a goal, like spend some time actually in thought, like get away. No electronics, no nothing, but you get out there and you spend time thinking. That's what a CEO's job is. Yeah. It's actually to produce thought. And where are you leading these bunch of knuckleheads? You know?
Well, I read a lot. I think a lot of entrepreneurs, I think some of the ones that I hang around with anyway, we like to read books. I do a lot of audio. Like, what are you reading?
Me
too. What should we be reading? What do I want to be reading?
You know, one of the big things that changed our organization is the book Traction. Yeah, so Gina Wickman, I believe, and Vern Harnash.
I think I got a copy over there. I haven't got to yet.
Right. So I'm actually on my fourth round, and now it's in the point of, okay, I need to read this about traction and this about process and, you know, X, Y, and Z. So one of the big things that I'm reading is a lot about hospitality. So, yes, we're a digital marketing company, but when you walk into our walls and you come in, you're greeted like you're walking into a restaurant.
Wow.
We stand, there's water, there's food. It's because we want you to, because honestly, like I look at my team, I go, do you guys, we have to say thank you. Like they're coming in to visit us, so that we have to view it that way. And we want you to know what, how thankful we are that you're even either A, coming to talk and paying us to do what we do.
Yeah.
So how do we go and make that hospitality? So a lot of Danny Meyer, you know, he's a big restaurateur out in New York, you know, what he does and some philosophies. So a lot about hospitality. I know it sounds weird.
Yeah.
But that's, it is, it's hospitality.
Well, I think if you, I mean, one of the things that I like to talk about a little bit on the show is how to be remarkable, how to be so different that people actually remember you. And maybe, you know, I call it the urinal effect. If we're, if you're at the urinal, right, and the guy on the left of you is talking about something and the guy to the right of you is talking about something, you know, if there's something, there's some buzz being created and you actually have a remarkability factor. If you can have people at the urinal talking about your business or what you do, if you're that different enough, you know, you can really get yourself known. So I kind of wonder that about, I mean, I don't know, walking into a marketing agency, you don't expect that people to stand up and greet you necessarily. I mean, that sounds very different.
It is, and that's what we want to do. And, and we say, they're not going to remember about the things you said, but they'll remember the way that you make them feel. So, and that's even in the good times and the bad times, because in our industry, things go up, down, sideways all the time. So how do we interact with them when it's good, when it's not so good, up, down, in between? That's where we want to, that's where we want to be.
That's really cool. Yep. Great thoughts. Okay, one last question. Just closing thoughts about other entrepreneurs. We know that there are people out there that aren't up to 15 employees yet, haven't grown a business fast. Maybe they're at the beginning stages or thinking about approaching entrepreneurship. Advice, what should they take away?
I would say probably what I have learned is build the team around you. If you try to do it yourself, you will fail. So build your team in accounting, build your team over in here and all that. Kind of, that's what I have learned at the beginning part of it. You try to do a lot and I was like, no, I can't do that. Right. So I always have to consistently keep my head in the clouds. That's where I want to be. That's actually a really exciting place. So I kind of get a buzz right about now because I'm planning for next and I get myself excited and I can bring that to the team. But I can't do that without other people. I can't do that without the certain people. And one part of my team leaves, like a CFO or whatever, you feel it. And that's what I want because that means I've done the right thing as far as building the team. Yeah. So when they leave, like you can feel it.
Is there one person who's been the most important part of your team?
Yes. And I would tell you right now it's my wife. Because without her support and her basically saying, hey, pull your head out of your ass. Oh, we can't say that on the radio. Sorry. Without her saying, hey, do this and keep going. When I get down on myself, there's no way I'd have a company. I would have folded 20 times ago.
Love the story. Love the inspiration. Put the right people around you, beginning with your spouse, Tyler Campbell. He is the founder and CEO of Tytanium Ideas. He's on Veterans Day. We salute you for entrepreneurship and your service to our country.
Thank you.
You betcha.
Thanks for having me on.
If you like our entrepreneurial stories, if you like the messages that we bring that inspire, if you want a little more Mark Haney, not everybody does, but if you do, feel free to subscribe. Feel free to be part of our community, engage, comment, share. I want to get to know you better. You want to get to know me better. Follow me on all our social media platforms at The Mark Haney. I look forward to knowing you better. And let's get to know each other better so we can help build these businesses that we love.